Namaskaram, Professor Ritha Rajan. It is very nice of you to have accepted this interview to share your thoughts and information on Veena Dhanammal. Veena Dhanammal is a very revered name in Carnatic music, and even youngsters today have heard a lot about her. Can you tell us a little bit about Veena Dhanammal?
Namaskaram, Praveena. I have also heard a lot about Veena Dhanammal. What I would say, first-hand information from her descendants, the granddaughters and the grandsons, and also from my family members at Kanchipuram. Here I must say a few words, some personal information about my family. My family was closely associated with Dhanammal's family, and also another musician. She was Kanchipuram Dhanakoti Amma. According to Dr. Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan, you must have heard his name, our former president of India. He used to say that Dhanammal, Dhanakoti Ammal, all these are household names in South India. That's what he used to say. So Dhanammal was such an influence in the Carnatic music world. What I'm saying is, Kanchipuram Dhanakoti Ammal, she was the aunt of the great Vidwan, Kanchipuram Nayana Pillai, from whom Dhanammal's granddaughters, Brindama and Muthamma, learned. And through Kanchipuram Dhanakoti Ammal, through Kanchipuram Nayana Pillai, who was a very close friend of my grandfather, we knew Dhanammal's family also very well. And we were also associated with her grandson, T. Shankaran, and especially Brindama and Muthamma, her granddaughters. So we have heard a lot, I have heard a lot about Dhanammal, and she was, as I said, such a respected name, and she was, she commanded so much respect and reverence from all the musicians and connoisseurs during her time.
Can you please tell us about a bit about her ancestry?
Dhanammal, actually, she hailed from Tanjavur. In certain books, I see that she was born in Georgetown, Chennai. But according to Dhanammal's grandson, T. Shankaran, she was born in Tanjavur in the year 1868. And she passed away in 1938. And her family, they were from Tanjavur. And the ancestor, the earliest ancestor that they are able to tell us is, was Papammal. Papammal, she belonged to the 17th or 18th century, I think. Then Papammal's daughter was Rukmini. Rukmini's daughter was the famous Tanjavur Kamakshi. She was the grandmother of Veena Dhanammal. And Tanjavur Kamakshi learned from Subbaraya Sastri. You must have heard about Subbaraya Sastri. He was the son of the famous, the great composer Shyama Sastri. So Tanjavur Kamakshi learned from Subbaraya Sastri, and also from Anai Ayya brothers. Tanjavur Kamakshi, the grandmother of Veena Dhanammal, had learned from these illustrious composers. And then Tanjavur Kamakshi's daughter was Sundarammal, who learned from Annasami Sastri, Subbaraya Sastri's adopted son. And then Dhanammal, of course. Yes.
You have mentioned about her ancestry. Yes. Veena Dhanammal. Can you talk a little bit about her tutelage and her gurus?
Yes. Now Dhanammal, she inherited a vast repertory from her mother, grandmother. And mainly the grandmother was a real source of inspiration for Dhanammal. That's what I have heard. And Dhanammal's guru, the main guru, was Sathanur Panchanadayya. He was also called Sathanur Panju Ayya. This Sathanur Panju Ayya or Panchanadayya, he was a very famous guru and musician. And he was the disciple of one Suddhamadalam Thambiyappa Pillai, who was the direct disciple of Muthuswami Dikshitar. So you can see that Dhanammal belongs to the lineage of Shyama Sastri first, and then Muthuswami Dikshitar also. From Sathanur Panchanadayya, along with Dhanammal, Her colleagues were Thirukodi Kaval Krishnayyar, who was a very famous violinist, and also Thirupambaram Swaminatha Pillai, not the flute player, his grandfather. Thirupambaram Swaminatha Pillai and his son Thirupambaram Nataraja Sundaram Pillai, who has edited 50 Kirtanas of Muthuswami Dikshitar. So these people were Dhanammal's colleagues. From Sathanur Panjadanatha Iyer, Dhanammal, Thirukodi Kaval Krishnayyar, and Thirupambaram Swaminatha Pillai and his son Nataraja Sundara Pillai, these artists learned. And then Dhanammal also learned Veena. Later she shifted to Georgetown in Chennai, and with the grandmother Tanjavur Kamakshi's great efforts, she could learn from one Adagaya Shankaraya who lived in Georgetown. And T. Sankaran used to say a lot about this Adagaya Shankaraya. He was the one who taught Dhanammal Veena initially. And then later, Dhanammal learned many Kshetraya Padams from one Padam Baldas. Of course, Kshetraya Padams are there in her family even prior to Dhanammal, because they belong to the Tanjavur court and they had inherited Kshetraya Padams even before. But later, Dhanammal had enriched the repertoire by learning many Kshetraya Padams from Padam Baldas, and the family gives more credit to Padam Baldas for their accumulation of Kshetraya Padams. Yes.
You mentioned that Muthuswami Dikshitar, and in relation to Shuddhamaddalam Thambiyappai.
Yes.
I have read that Dikshitar has composed certain kritis such as Divakaratunajam.
Yes.
To cure the stomach ailment, yes, that his disciple,
yes,
had.
Yes.
And can you tell us, I believe Veena Dhanammal had some special association with these kritis. Can,
yes, you, yes. Now these call these kirtanas, Divakaratunajam and Surya Murten, etc., Chandram Bhajamansa, as a Navagraha kirtanas. Now, in those days, these kirtanas were known as Vara kirtanas, Varamna, the week. The kirtanas to be rendered during the week. And how many days are there in the week? 7 days. So the kirtanas were actually 7 in number in those days. And in Dhanammal's family, they were called Vara Kirtanas. And it is said that this Shuddhamaddalam Thambiyappai Pillai, who was the disciple of, who was the guru of Sathanur Panjadanatha Iyer, he had severe stomach ache. And his guru, the great Muthuswami Dikshitar, who was also a very good astrologer, he examined Shuddhamaddalam Thambiyappai Pillai's horoscope and suggested that he worshipped Saturn, Shani, as well as Brihaspati, Guru. He said that both the planet Saturn and Jupiter, were not strong in his horoscope. So he composed the Kirtanas Divakara Tanujam and Brihaspate Namostute, and asked Shuddhamaddalam Thambiyappai Pillai to sing them regularly, and he got cured of his stomach affliction. Then later it is said that Muthuswami Dikshitar added further kirtanas and made them into a group of 7. So they were called Vara Kirtanas, and it was only Dhanammal. She was the source for all 7 kirtanas, and many musicians had learned these Vara Kirtanas from her directly, especially Paru Sundaram Iyer, the renowned violinist, father of Paru Anandanabh Iyer and M.S. Gopalakrishna Iyer. Their father, Paru Sundaram Iyer, he was such an, he had all respect for Dhanammal. He and some of his associates, they went to Veena Dhanammal and learned all the Vara Kirtanas from her so religiously with all dedication. Yes.
Veena Dhanammal was known for her vast repertoire.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about this repertoire that she is known for?
Before that, I think, yes, we'll keep that question next. I think I have to say some more about Dhanammal's contacts. And I told you about Veena Dhanammal's gurus.
Yes.
Adagaya Shankaraya, yes. Padam Baldas, and a number of composers and musicians used to visit Dhanammal. Dharmapuri Subbarayan, the famous Javali composer, he was a regular visitor to Dhanammal's house and he had great respect for her. And many Javalis were composed in Dhanammal's house. And there is in fact one Javali, you must have heard, Smaras Sundaranguni Sariyavare in Faras. That Javali is in praise of Veena Dhanammal. Just about who is equal to this lady. I mean, I just give you the general meaning of that Javali and the way she plays Veena, the greatness of her Veena playing and all. It's all described in that Javali, and this Javali was dedicated to Veena Dhanammal by Dharmapuri Subbarayan. Unfortunately, nowadays it is being choreographed as a female dancer describing about her lover. It's given a different interpretation. I don't think it's correct. It was a Javali which was composed in praise of Veena Dhanammal by Dharmapuri Subbarayan at her very house. Then Patnam Subramani Ayya, he was also a regular visitor to Dhanammal's house, and Dhanammal had a very good repertoire of Patnam Subramani Ayya's Kirtanas, and her daughter Lakshmi Ratanammal or Chennakutti Ammal, she had learned so many Kirtanas of Patnam Subramani Ayya directly from the composer. Yes, what was your question?
Regarding her vast repertoire,
yes.
That she is known for, can you tell us a little bit about this repertoire?
Yes. See, Dhanammal was so much regarded for her very extensive repertoire. None of her colleagues or those musicians who lived during her period had that kind of repertoire. I mean, she had heritage that was left to her, a legacy that was left to her by her ancestors. She learnt a lot by herself, and also her descendants, they were made to and further add to the repertoire. So this is the greatness of her repertoire. And the speciality about her repertoire is, within the repertoire you find so many repertoires. See, it's not just one repertoire, it is a huge repertoire. In that you find Varnam, take Varnam, it's a huge repertoire in itself. Then take Kirtanas, you have Shyama Sastri, you have Muthuswami Dikshita compositions, Subrahma Dikshita compositions, and then Patnam Subramani Ayya, and the Kirtana repertoire is so huge, so extensive. Then of course the Kshetraya Padams, Javalis, then so many Tamil compositions from Nandanar Charitam. The family knows so many compositions, and also the Tamil Padas of Vaidyeswaran Koyil Subramayyar, Ghanam Krishnayyar and other composers. It's such an extensive something, you just cannot think of such a huge repertoire in those days. And she was the only person who had such a respectable and amazing repertoire. And the repertoire, now see, actually in Carnatic music, this repertoire is a term used in Western music. But they mean it in a different sense, whereas we here just say it is a stock of songs. Patantaram, we say in Tamil. Professor Samuti has used the term repertoire, and he also gives the meaning for the term repertoire as patantara, collection. But it's not just collection. According to Western musicians, that repertoire is not just a collection. The way you render the repertoire, how do you specialize your repertoire, how do you internalize your repertoire, all this is included in the term repertoire, not just a mere collection. Yes, I know so many Varnams, you know so many Kirtanas, but how many have you specialized? Can you sing all of them just like that? You have to master them, you have to internalize, you have to specialize them. So this kind of specialization, this kind of mastery over all the compositions that was there in her repertoire. So you get the real, the significant meaning of the term repertoire when you say that Dhanammal had a huge, extensive repertoire. Brindama has told me that she knew about 500 or 600 slokas. Everything in oral tradition. Ah, that's very important. They never, even to this day, they do not have notebooks or even the present family members. I mean, to the extent I know, Vegavahini, Brindama's daughter, she cannot sing from a notation or from a notebook. She has to sing from her memory. It's a very great virtue, a great value in our tradition, the oral tradition, Karna Parampare we say in Tamil. So whatever was learned, that was learned by listening and imbibing, not from books, not from notation. So you just listen and get it absorbed into your system. Now, that kind of oral tradition is very strictly followed in Dhanammal's repertoire.
In the vast repertoire that you have just mentioned, and you have said that they are specialized in certain
yes.
things. So you have mentioned earlier that Varnams, Kirtanas, yes. such as there are some specialities in the Varnam technique, also singing Swara Sahityam, that technique.
Yes.
And also, as you had mentioned, the shlokas that she
yes.
has sung. Can you just elaborate on those aspects?
Yes. For example, let us take the Varnam. How do you normally sing a Varnam? Please, just sing a snatch of a Varna. Okay, why did you choose this Kala Pramanam? You want to sing a second speed of
yes.
the Varna.
Yeah.
Okay. They never sang second speed. The very Kala Pramana taken up was Sarasudayanilekodi. What do you find anything other than the speed and up Kala Pramana?
Explicit showing of each.
Yes, that accent, that throb.
Yes.
They believe, they very much believe that the Varna should have that throb. Because Thana Varnam Solcha and the Thana and the accent Varnam Solva. They used to insist that Thana accent should, you call it Thana Varnam. So that Thana accent should be there when you sing the Thana Varnam. So, like that, the throb should be there. They were very particular about this. And regarding the Swara Sahitya, I must, yes, it's a very good question. Swara Sahitya, in this particular tradition of Veena Dhanammal, in her family, when there was, the rendering was done in duet, you will see, when the Swara Sahitya portion, especially for Kirtan of Shyama Sastri or Subrahi Sastri was taken up, usually, how do we sing? We sing the swara after the anupalavi, then the sahitya after the channa. That is the procedure. Okay, but when this, I mean, the same kirtanas, the swara sahitya was rendered as duets in Dhanammal's family. Simultaneously, the swara and sahitya will be sung. That is when Brindama and Muktama sang. Brindama after the anupalavi, she would sing the swara. And simultaneously, Muktama will sing the Sahitya. Like that, it used to go. This is something very new. You wouldn't have heard anywhere. This is a kind of tradition that has been followed. And I was told by T. Shankaran that this was suggested by Annasami Sastri to Sundarambal, Dhanammal's mother. When they sang in duets, why don't one person sing the swara and the other person the sahityana? Sometimes I was, what would have made them do like this? You know? Probably this is a kind of practice in old Bharatanatyam recitation in those days. I will I had an opportunity to work with Thirukkokarnam Ranganayaki Ammal. You wouldn't have heard their name. Her name, very respectable dance teacher. She belonged to Pudukote. She also learnt Mridangam from Pudukote, Dakshinamurthy Pillai. Thirukkokarnam Ranganayaki Ammal. That lady, she was teaching dance and I used to be there. And she made me sing for the dancers, her dance students. And as I was singing, she used to recite jatis, Tirmanam, Solva, dancer. Usually, Pennana, the singing will be stopped. But singing, she will ask me to continue the singing and simultaneously, she will sing the jatis. So singing as well as the jati, the Tirmanam will go on simultaneously.
You also mentioned about the shlokas and her singing and playing of the shlokas thing.
Dhanammal knew at least 500, 600 shlokas. And all the shlokas she just remembered, especially during the, towards the end of her life, she became blind. She never referred to any notebook, just sang from memory. And all these shlokas she could sing from memory. And in her, the shloka rendition, especially by Dhanammal, along with the playing of the Veena, and later by her granddaughter, Vrindama, they are very strikingly beautiful. They were so strikingly beautiful. And the shlokas were rendered so beautifully. Shloka singing was something unique in Dhanammal's repertoire. Nariya Desiya Ragas she used to make use of while rendering the shlokas. And there is one Kulantharum Shelvam, or Alvarudaiya Pasuram. That she has given a record in Kapi Raga. You will see a very, you can see the influence of Hindustani music in that. And later I will tell you about her association and with the Hindustani musicians and her, how she used to enjoy listening to Hindustani music. Yes.
Veena players are known for their technique.
Yes.
Can you tell us about Veena Dhanammal's playing technique?
Yes. She lived in a period which was dominated by all male stalwarts on the instrument Veena, like Veena Seshanna and others, and it was all technique oriented. Amongst them, she was the only lady musician playing the Veena who commanded equal respect. And what was her technique? According to T. Shankaran, that her meat or the plucking of the Veena string was, it had a kind of melodic continuity, and she never used the metallic plectrums. She used to pluck with her hands and with the flesh. She couldn't grow nails in the fingers much, so she used to pluck the strings with the flesh of the fingers. And it was very powerful, but not overpowerful. It was very strong, very melodious, continuous. That's what he used to say. It was very continuous. And the thala strings, they never used the side strings, she never used them as thala strings. Okay? Not as thala strings, as shruti strings. So whenever it was required, she just plucked the thala strings as for the shruti accompaniment only. She would not use them as thala strings. The regular, you would have heard in Veena playing,
yes,
the regular plucking of the thala strings will be there to ascertain the thala. Now, that kind of plucking was not there in Dhanammal's technique. And also, Shankaran sir has told me that she used to keep the pitch of the Veena strings a little higher so that she could sing along with it. This was a very important feature of Dhanammal's music. She just did not play the Veena. She also sang along with the Veena. You must have heard about, you must have heard Mahima Theliya Tharamma on the YouTube. Yes. Now watch the Kala Pramana. I heard the same Kirtana. Mahima Teliya Tadamani Mahima. So it is being sung with a kind of verb, whereas here Mahima Teliya Teli, all those nuances, please just look for those nuances. These Dhanammal's music was replete with such kinds of subtle nuances, subtle ornamentations, which was something you wouldn't find in the rest of the music, in others' music. But I mean, this is something very special about Dhanammal. The setting of the Kala Pramana, it's so such a comfortable Kala Pramana. Within that, all nuances, they will be so beautifully incorporated. Yes.
I've also heard that she was the first musician to have played the Ganaraga Tanam.
Yes, she has played the Tanam in the five Ganaragas in just 7 minutes. And it's a very beautiful music recording. You must listen to that. What is interesting is that you will find that she has not played Sriraga as the fifth Ganaraga. Sriraga is the fourth and Varali is the fifth. So that was the older tradition. What do we say? Nata Gaula, Arabi, Varali, Sri. No. Nata Gaula, Arabi, Sri and Varali. So she has followed that tradition. That is something very interesting. Yes. You can play a little bit of that.
Concerts and public performances.
Yes. Dhanammal used to perform on Fridays in her Georgetown house, which was attended by the elite of the Chennai, the Madras music world. And they were much looked forward to. And all the leading musicians and connoisseurs, musicians like Tirukodi Kaval Krishnayyar, Mridagam Narayan Sami Appa, and others, Thiruvavudu Durai Rajaratnam Pillai, and connoisseurs like Kirtanacharya, C.R. Srinivas Iyengar, you must have heard his name, T.T. Krishnamacharya, and all these people, S.Y. Krishna Swami, these people used to attend it. And I must say a special word about S.Y. Krishna Swami. He has written a beautiful article about Tiger Vardhacharya and Veena Dhanam. Tiger Vardhacharya had great admiration and respect for Veena Dhanam. He was also a regular visitor. Sarva Sastri, the great flute vidwan. Such great vidwans and connoisseurs, they were regular visitors to her Friday concerts, attended with pin drop silence. One musician has actually, he has referred to it as the Friday Pilgrim. He has just called himself as the Friday Pilgrim. So he was a regular visitor, he was a regular listener to Dhanammal's concerts on Fridays in her residence. So he describes his visit to Dhanammal's house on Fridays as the Friday Pilgrimage, and describes himself as the Friday Pilgrim. So you can imagine how these Friday sessions at Dhanammal's residence were so much looked forward to, how they were enjoyed, how they drew the entire attention of all the music loving public in Madras in those days. And no one would ask her to perform this or that. Whatever she wanted to sing or perform, they just listened to it. Very few had the privilege to ask her to play something. No? Then apart from that, every year in the Music Academy's annual conference, she would play, and very selected concerts. She was not performing, I mean, what you say, box office hitter, like what we say nowadays. No, very selective, very choosy, and she was very exclusive. She was called an aristocrat among the musicians. She was called an aristocrat. And she regarded Veena as a complete instrument. She never heard any accompaniments. She never heard any mridangam or any, no accompaniment. And she had also had her views regarding music. She did not like lady musicians to sing aggressively like male musicians and doing the tala so vigorously. And she had her own views. And her family, they would not, they played Veena, they played tana on the Veena, but they would not sing tana. In one of the concerts, Brindama's daughter Vegavagini sang Pallavi in the Music Academy. She just sang the raga and then the Pallavi. I was so surprised. I went and asked her. She said, no, in our tradition we don't sing tana.
Can you tell us a little bit about her interactions with other musicians? You had mentioned that she was very fond of Hindustani music.
Yes.
So can you tell us a little
bit about that? She had a great interaction with her colleagues, Thirukodikaval Krishnayar, and who had all respect for her music. And you would have heard about Thiruvavudurai Rajaratna Pillai, the Nagaswaram legend. He had the most admiration and regard for his guru, Thirukodikaval Krishnayar, and Veena Dhanammal. And he used to visit her house a number of times and play for her, and whatever she wanted to, she wanted to play for her. Now, then all the musicians, Thiruvottiyur Thyagayari, you must have heard, the famous Varna composer, he was a regular visitor. He used to compose Varnas, and he also taught his daughter Lakshmi Ratanambal, and so many other musicians, Sarva Sastrigal, and Koneri Rajapuram Vaidyanath Iyer. There's a very rare photograph of all the famous musicians, Kumbakonam, Azhaganambiya Pillai, Mridangam, and all the great musicians, vidwans of those days. And in that group photo, the only lady musician is Veena Dhanammal. So you can imagine the kind of respect and the special place she enjoyed during her times. And she was also very, she used to like to Hindustani music. The great Abdul Karim Khan, who belonged to the Kirana Gharana, he was a regular visitor to Dhanammal's house whenever he visited Madras. And he used to sing for hours for Dhanammal only. And he also learnt a few kirtanas from Veena Dhanammal. Some of them are Entane Chinna. ఎంత నే చిన్నాచ ఫలమేమో ఎంత నే లైక్ దిస్ హీ హాస్ సంగ్ వెరీ ఇంట్రెస్టింగ్ అండ్ హీ హాస్ ఆల్సో సంగ్ రామణి సమానం ఎవరు ఆల్ దీస్ దీస్ రికార్డ్స్ ఐ థింక్ యూ కెన్ లిసన్ టు ఆన్ ద యూట్యూబ్ కెన్ యూ జస్ట్ ప్లే దట్ అబ్దుల్ కరీం ఖాన్స్ రామణి సమానం ఎవరు And there was also one famous sitarist, Nawab Ali Khan. He had, he used to admire and enjoy Dhanammal's music, and he used to visit her. And Dhanammal had also made a number of trips to Kashi. And she used to like Hindustani music very much. And you can see the influence, as I told you, in the sloka singing, and also in the javalis and all. For us, there is Pratimadhima in the javali. Here, we don't accept Pratimadhima, but in the earlier version of Desiya Ragas, in the Raga Faras, you have Pratimadhima. Even now, in Hindustan music, there is Pratimadhima in the Raga Faras. So this was the kind of influence that Dhanammal had by listening to Hindustan music and also adapting certain features.
What is the Veena Dhanammal Bani?
Yes.
Can you tell us, did she create it? Or what is this bani that we talk about today?
In this context, I must ask you to read an article by Dr. V. Raghavan. He has written an article in the Madras Music Academy Journal, The Popular and the Classical in Music. It is a 1957 journal. He has just said what is popular and what is classical. Now, coming to Dhanammal's bani, I feel it is a very classical bani. That is, when you say bani, a particular style by which you can recognize the musician, or when that style is being sung by some other musician who has been following or who has been taught by that particular musician, you recognize the bani. Now, regarding Dhanammal's bani, I feel she created something, some style that would suit the represent the past tradition, that suited the present tradition, and it would also be relevant for the future. This is what I feel. She could integrate the best aspects of the past. She could create best aspects by herself and also by imbibing from her the system of, I mean, the kind of music that was going during her time. And she also thought about future. She beautifully integrated, and she created a bani, a style that is something, I mean, it can withstand time, whether it is, I mean, if you just listen to Dhanammal's music and also listen to the music of those who lived during her times, you can see that she is quite far ahead compared to what was sung, what was played during her time. You listen to all the music that was present during her time, and also listen to Dhanammal. Then you listen to her music now. You don't know about future. We don't know what it's going to be. But what I feel is, whatever she sang and played, I mean, it was so contemporary in her days. It is still contemporary now, and it is going to be contemporary even for future. So this is something which stands the test of time.
We hear about the Shishya Parampara. Yes. Of many Banis and many Gurus that have a Shishya Parampara. Would we call Veena Dhanammal's Bani a Shishya, I mean the Shishya Parampara, or as you have mentioned earlier, a Sangeeta Parampara?
Yes. This is a Sangeeta Parampara. In Carnatic music we say Shishya Parampara. But prior to Shishya Parampara, we must give credit to the Sangeeta Paramparas that have been there in our tradition, not only in our tradition, take any tradition, take Western music. You have the famous family of the Bach family, which been there for so many years, more than a century like that. Then take the Dagar brothers in Hindustani music, so many generations like that. We have illustrious musical families in Carnatic music. One of such illustrious family in Carnatic music is Veena Dhanammal's Parampara, Sangeeta Parampara. Shishya Parampara comes only later, according to me. Sangeeta Parampara is something unique for any renowned system of music in the world, the Bach musical family, the Dagan's musical family, the Dhanammal's musical family, and Kanchipuram Dhanakoti Amma's musical family. So that is, we must be proud of the Sangeeta Paramparas of all these great music systems.
Thank you, Professor Ritha.
Thank you. It
for
is
giving us such a wonderful interview on such an illustrious musician, Veena Dhanammal.
Thank you.